I didn't break the planet. It was this way when I found it, all right?
Everybody laughed when I first said I wanted to be a comedian. Well, they're not laughing now, are they?
You know why it's nominated, don't you? To catch the tears of joy.
It's a Celtic phoenix. People are thankfully being stupid again.
Welcome
to Gurus of Comedy.
With your host, Dave Keeshan.
And welcome to the Gurus of Comedy. I'm here with Andrew Paskin, all the way from Australia, stuck in lockdown in Australia on Good Friday. How's it going over there?
Mate, fantastic. It couldn't be better.
That's what I always liked about you, Andrew. You're so positive. You just kind of what are you up to these days? Like, I moved back from Australia to be 7 years ago now, and you were studying
like
at the time.
It feels like a lifetime ago.
It was. One of the last times I ever saw you, I'd lost my job and was walking the streets of Sydney and just bumped into you.
Yeah, I mean, I completely forgotten that till you jog my memory pre-show, and that was a surreal moment. I was like, is that Dave Keeshan?
Yeah, no, it's kind of weird when you have a job for a long time and then they tell you don't have to come in the next day. You don't really know what to do.
So did they walk you out with security so you didn't steal any paper clips and that type of thing?
No, they didn't. They let so many people go. There was like about 100 of us. They couldn't do that. So we just kind of had to run at the place. But I know, it was quite respectful. So what have you been up to? Like, you've been, when you were kind of an up-and-comer around about the same time I was, but you've kind of moved on a bit. I just completed my Sydney Comedy Festival show about then. And you've kind of done that since then. Haven't you done Fringe and a few other things?
Yeah, but I mean, I'm pretty much anti-festivals. I'm more a club guy, you know?
Right. Are you still clubbing or have you?
Yeah, I'm talking about club comedy, not like glow sticks and dance
That's
music.
What I meant.
But Hacienda.
But like the whole scene's kind of changed. It's all like bringers and sign-up sheets. And what's it like now?
The scene's quite vibrant, but it's also like quite shit. Like the quality's dipped a lot. There's like far more quantity and far less quality. So basically, cool. It's just burning the audience of Sydney further into the ground. So comedy's slowly strangling itself in Sydney.
Nice. But you've got a paying gig these days, don't you? You're off writing at the moment for... What are you writing for?
Well, yeah, I work for a game show called Mastermind, which I think you have in the UK as well, but ours is the Australian version, obviously. So I'm a question producer and writer for that.
That's...
A couple of seasons.
That's... Okay, that's not... The Mastermind I know, which is in... the United Kingdom, that's kind of serious. That's it's not you don't write questions for yucks, do you? They're actually serious questions.
Yeah, serious. Yeah, it's for hardcore nerds, the show.
Oh yeah. So like, what are some of the more interesting kind of specialist questions you've had to write for?
Oh man, there's like, because obviously if you have a specialty, you want to pick one that you know all about. So like, I've had these like specialist doctors as contestants that have one part of the endocrine system is their speciality, and then they give you two journals, and you know, it's like, if you can't get 10 out of 10 for that doctor, you should be struck off.
Yeah, but I always kind of wondering if I go on that, it'd probably be some type of I'd like to think I could do like Star Trek, but then like the questions, I'm sure it would be like some completely super random questions that they're just going out of the way to try and mess you up on.
No, but let me give you an inside tip there, David, because you give them the sources. The specialist questions, you give two source materials, and all the questions are out of those materials. So if you give two thin books and you memorize the whole two books, you can't get it wrong.
All right, okay. Inside baseball there. So they can't go off and, you know, watch the 635 hours of Star Trek behind your back and find questions there?
No, and I don't think you'd find anyone that nerdy either.
Well, fair enough. Cool. Oh, that's cool. I have to keep an eye out for that. And like, do you have any kind of have you ever kind of swapped in a hallmark or some type of into the question? You know, like, oh, that's, you can tell that's one that Andrew's written.
No, but I mean, I mean, most of them I'm editing and verifying as opposed to writing. I just do some writing. So yeah, like the questions are way above my head, to be honest with you, most of the time. Like, I thought I had great general knowledge beforehand. I realized I didn't.
So I lived in America, I lived in Australia, would have watched UK TV, obviously Irish TV. So I've seen like the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, four different countries properly, as in, you know, it was on the TV and you kind of be watching it. And, you know, you're right, general knowledge. I'm always like, really good, get that one, get this one. And then always gets to the sport question. And the sport's always like some local sport. And I'm like, and I'm out. Don't even have a...
Sorry, man, yeah. Let me ask you this question. Is America the dumbest of all the questions?
No. Like, they all start off dumb, you know. They have, was it Regis Philbin was the guy who did it, like, who wants to be a millionaire? And they'd always, you know, and it's like, you know, they would always have it, you know, is that your final answer? You know, it's like, the way he said it is like, if he's asking you that question, it's wrong. You know, he's never asking you that question when it's right, you know. But no, Eddie Maguire, he was pretty good. He kind of was a bit more serious. Yeah, no, it's the sport. Sport would always kill me. But you get up to those big questions, I'd say they're probably mastermind plus. So what we have you here today is your specialist subject, which I think is one-liners. One-liners and one-liner comedians. You had that joke, I don't know if you retired it yet, but it was, hey dad, you still do that?
I don't do that because it's way out of topical rain, but I've also sort of moved on from straight one-liners these days, but I still have a passion for them.
Okay,
that joke was very filthy. It's up there with the Jimmy Carr style because it's pedophile based.
Yeah, well, let's kind of go from there because I've kind of noticed that because a lot of these one-liners they go really deep and dark. It's almost like they're going for the punch. It's like, how much can I get you from here to there as fast as possible? Like, I think, Jimmy Carr, I actually found this one. It's actually very hard to find. He was on this TV show called 10 O'Clock Show, and he did this one. Technically, wouldn't be one-liner anymore, but it definitely comes from, it was written as a one-liner that kind of got extended. Let's just kind of see where it goes.
The government is spending £200 million scrapping 9 Nimrod spy planes. I've got a couple of ideas to save that money. Fly the planes into buildings in Saudi Arabia and see how they like it. Too much? Oh, too late. It's live, what can you do?
Really hard to find that one, but he is famous for one-liners, but that one he kind of I think I don't know if he ever did it again because it was live, he got it out, but that is kind of really pushing it. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean it's just a shock joke to me. I mean, I think it's very well written though, really well written.
He would be kind of known as those one-liners, but you kind of have a lot of them, like Rodney Dangerfield, Phylis Diller. They all kind of, those last two, they seem to go very much on the self-deprecation, you know. It's like, if I can pick on someone, I can pick on myself.
Yeah, which, I mean, in that era, that was totally new and, not new, but it was totally acceptable and it wasn't considered old hat in that era. So they were brilliant and they still stand the test of time today. But if you just did that the whole time now, you'd be kind of corny. But I find Jimmy Carr corny with the constant pedophile jokes and constant shock. Like, it's to me, like, I don't know how he can have 5 hours of one-liners and they're all the same joke.
Is that jealousy? How do you get 5 hours? Yeah, but
I mean, just the work ethic of that alone is something to write a thesis on.
So let's just try got the Rodney Dangerfield one.
Well, one girl told me, come on over, there's nobody home. I went over, there was nobody home.
That, to me, is the perfect joke because not only is it a funny joke, is it's perfectly symmetrical. It's got rhymes all through it. The symmetry of it's just beautiful. It's musical.
Yeah, he probably one of his more famous jokes, but he kind of always has that kind of patter. Ba-bum, 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 ba-bum.
That one just, to me, that's perfection.
He's like, I don't get no respect.
That's his catchphrase, yeah.
This was one of my ones I always thought was like one of the masters is Stephen Wright. Though he kind of complained, like he finds it very hard to write. When he released his first album, like I Got a Pony, he says he was pretty much put out of business because he wiped out his hour. But let me just share one of his ones. This is kind of this is when he was actually on The Simpsons.
I finally got around to reading the dictionary. Turns out the zebra did it.
I mean that kind of it is him saying that joke, but it's also him kind of almost doing a pastiche of himself, of his own jokes. And
yeah.
I don't know, maybe that gets a bit meta, but like his, he just stood up and just does this kind of line after line after line after line.
And but he was meta before meta was cool.
Yeah, yeah. Well, like, he's kind of ahead of it. Like his, God, I can't believe now. He does what the K Billy D voice in Reservoir Dogs.
Reservoir Dogs, yeah.
Which is what we're pushing nearly 25 years in that, and he was meant to be kind of an old man at that point.
But interesting story about him, like Barry Katz, the famous manager, comedy manager and club owner. He said, like, Stephen Wright's the only guy that went from open mics to theatres and stayed in theatres.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he just blew up so much from Johnny Carson that he just went straight to theatres, and he's just been doing theatres ever since.
That's crazy. 40 years. Yeah, no, he's, like, solid. I've not never actually seen him live. I think, has he ever travelled? Have you ever been to Oz? I don't know. I've never seen him in Ireland.
I don't know. But, I mean, I'd love to see him live.
Like, some of them you wouldn't be quite as well known for one-liners. I'm a big Dennis Miller fan, more of his material.
I love it.
Not his politics, but this was a... He would like to play with words a lot, so this was one of his ones I always thought was kind of his famous joke. One that I nearly had to go back... like, I always found I had to go back to college to try and figure out what the hell he meant.
Use of words like genealogy, which I think most Americans believe to be when Barbara Eden visits her OB-GYN.
Which it took me forever to figure out that he was talking about I Dream of Jeannie, Barbara Eden.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's
yeah.
Like you almost have to write it down and go off to the library and figure that one out. He lost a lot of people, I think, just by his references. Actually, there is a famous Family Guy where they make fun of him, where he's like, I don't want to get off and around here, but you know, it was that one genealogy with Barbara Eden's Opie Gine, and your man goes, what the hell does rant mean? you sent Mitch Hedberg in. He was never really on my radar. There was this one here that you sent on.
This shirt is dry clean only, which means it's dirty.
Perfect joke.
Which I hadn't heard. Someone must have been copying his material, because there was one of his jokes, you know, the problem with an escalator that's broken, it's a stairs.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, yeah. Sorry for the...
He's one of the most ripped-off comedians of all time.
Yes, sorry for the convenience. And yeah. I'm sure someone was doing that joke, but I thought it was their joke until I heard it, that one. Because I had an interesting one. It's like that kind of weird feeling. You walk onto an escalator expecting it to be working when it's broken, and your head just kind of has that kind of weird shimmy. And it's like, it's just the stairs, just the stairs. You know, the one-liners, they don't seem to be as popular anymore. It was kind of, if you look at the list, it's kind of older. Going back, it was Rodney Dangerfield and Phylis Diller. Is anyone kind of really at that level at this anymore? Maybe Jimmy Carr?
Well, there's loads of English guys, like Gary Delaney, and that guy wears a soccer ball on his head. He's quite famous.
Tim Vine, is it?
Tim Vine, yeah. Like, but they're sort of like pun, like really corny puns, most of them.
Right.
But... I thought it was quite big in England, at least. I mean, Ireland's all about storytelling, right?
Yeah, I've only started doing stand up here. I'd probably be more along the American lines of just observation and punchline. Whereas the people here, they definitely get into their stories a lot more, which is terrible for 5 minutes. It's like, you got 5 minutes, you know, and they're kind of going on and on about trying to set up the story for a punchline, and it's a good joke, but it's 5 minutes for one punchline. You know, you're not getting it from the other guy who's kind of like rattling them out every 30 seconds. So it's kind of very different.
It's interesting juxtaposition that, because the reason I got out of one-liners solely, like I still do them sometimes, but as Stephen Wright says, it just takes so long to write like enough good ones to have 10 or 20 minutes of one-liners. But also... the audience, I find, can't sit through more than about 12 minutes of one-liners unless you're a really, really, really skilled comedian. Mm. So, but then storytelling, if you, like you said, if you bomb with one story, you've bombed for 5 minutes, you know?
I think, yeah, you definitely see the difference when you go from 5 to 10 to 15 to 20 and all the way up to an hour. And, like, you know, the 5 minutes is kind of, I saw someone describe like how you actually make a Mission Impossible movie. And it's like 6 action sequences of 5 minutes each strung together. That's how you make it. So the kind of, when you start off as a stand-up and you're doing your 5 minutes, that's great. But when you kind of want to move up to the next level or change, you kind of have to, I know, yeah, you have to, it's a bit like more like a waves. You kind of have to do your 5 minutes with a build up and then back off and start again and back off and start again to kind of keep the night going. Because if it's just the same intensity out of the gate for an hour, people are knackered.
I really found that, like, with what I was doing, and there's a genius one-liner comedian in Sydney called Bruce Griffith. He's been going, like, 25 years.
Mm.
And he's almost, he's very Stephen Wright-esque, actually.
Actually, yeah, he is very much. What was his one? I like one of his one, his laser hair removal. It's like, if I had laser hair, I'd keep it.
Yeah, he's a genius, right?
But, which I always just think is kind of, it's a great line. It's just so obvious on when someone says it, but you just don't see it until it's been said.
Yeah, but like, I mean, even he finds that anything more than about 15 minutes is just too much of his stuff, you know, for the audience to concentrate for, because it's very cerebral, you know?
Mm. So yeah, you said you moved off and now you're kind of, are you now like an old storyteller?
No, I can't tell a story to save my life, even though I have Irish blood.
All right.
But I still do very short, punchy stuff, but it's more like a chunk of things on one topic and more opinion-based now. But I still open with my best one-liner, which is, I base my life on this saying, winners have parties, losers have meetings. My parents taught me that at my 12th birthday meeting.
Yeah. I was about to do a tag.
That's my opening joke to this day. So
yeah, no, that's good. The homeschooling. Well, geez, there'll be a lot of kids now probably who'll have homeschooling experiences. They'll be forever scarred by it.
Yeah.
What's it like? Yeah, Dennis Miller has one similar like that. It's I was bullied mercilessly when I was in school. I was homeschooled.
Yeah, yeah. So that was original back in the day, but that's been ripped off 1,000 times. Why not?
Oh, I'm sure it has. But like every joke, kind of you move around, that used to kill me when trying to write fresh and new material. It's like I could just see, oh, that's a bit like someone's joke, or this is like that one joke. And then, you know, it's a bit like stories. There's only really like 7 stories. You know, it's only like 7 jokes, really. You know, just kind of iterations on it.
I think every joke's been done by now, if you look at the internet.
It's not quite as bad. It used to be like at the start of Twitter, like everyone's like, oh, I got an idea, get it on Twitter, just so you can have like a timestamp on when you kind of created it.
Yeah, and no one gives a fuck. They still steal it.
Oh, well, that's true. Like, so who do you think is the best one-liner then? Is it Dangerfield?
I think Rodney Dangerfield, but he had a lot of writers as well. So that sort of takes it away a little bit.
You think?
Therefore, Stephen Wright, well, he's the best character and performer of great one-liners. But I think if you don't write them all yourself, you should lose points.
Okay, so Stephen Wright is the man. Have you come across like much of Bob Monkhouse's stuff?
No, I've heard about Bob Monkhouse. Always hear it in glowing terms.
Yeah, I wouldn't be, like, he'd be massive. He kind of got into like TV presenting, and I was actually a bit taken, part of this podcast idea came from just wanting to talk about comedy, and it was actually come from the movie The Joker. When there's that famous line, it's actually on in the trailer where he's like telling a joke, you know, it's like, when I was young, I wanted to be a comedian. There's no one laughing now. Which it's played like as it's crap, but that's actually Bob Monkhouse's joke. And it's a great joke. And
I thought that was a Tommy Cooper joke. So like in the old days, they used to share all the jokes.
Right. Okay. Oh, no, I think that would be, he'd be famous for that one at least. It just, when you, I found a video of him performing it, it's amazing to put the two side by side, which is meant to be a bad comic with a good joke and a good comic with a good joke. And it's like, right. No, it's still a good joke.
See, a good modern one-liner comedian has been Demetri Martin.
Right.
But then, see, I like the ones that are clever and not just like wordplay. Like I find the puns and that just really terrible, which seem to be big in England for some reason, but... These guys are using, he was in some Ivy League schools, and he's a lawyer in some Ivy League school, so he's like highly intelligent, and he's just got a clever way of looking at the world. So like he's a very cerebral as well. Stephen Wright's are more like off with the pixies, and Mitch Hedberg's are more drug fucked, and then
But is it the more Demetri the, like, how much does his material, like, are they writing the material to be generic and last forever? Or is it, is there some material that it'll only work for the next 2 years and it's spent? Is it kind of a commentary?
No, that guy's got timeless jokes. Like, yeah. Same as Hedberg. They're not, and Stephen Wright, they're not topically dependent, you know?
Right.
The I think one of Demetri Martin's best ones was, he goes, you can say I like children. It's when you get specific that you get in trouble. I like 12-year-olds.
Okay, so we're back to it's still the contentious. It's still the bordering up against the social norms against the norms.
That's really a bad example, actually, because that's probably the only pedophile joke. Let me find one on the internet. Hang on.
Which you seem to know all of them, is it?
Employee of the month is a good example of when someone can be a winner and a loser at the same time.
Okay, that's good. So that's our one-liners. Are you thinking of getting back into it now? Have we convinced you of the success of it? Is it like?
Well, I mean,
put it down to being, is it artistry or is it a skill or is it a technique? Like, I think I heard Norm Macdonald recently say that writing jokes are easy, as in you do it enough years, you know the technique. It's not hard anymore.
Yeah, I saw that quote by him. It was just a bit disappointing. He was basically saying that comedy is not art, and like Russian literature is art. It's like, I think they're both art personally, but I think one-liners, when they're at their finest, are the most pure form of comedy. The zero fat, not a syllable wasted, classic original one-liner can't be beaten for mine. But
that's like, isn't it Seinfeld saying, edit, if a word can be taken away, take it away. So that's true of comedy in general, right? If it's not needed to make the joke funny, take it out.
Yeah, absolutely. But more so for one-liners than any other type of comedy.
Can you bubble it down to nothing? I don't know. It's a tough one, you know.
Well, it's that Jimmy Carr joke, which is a genius joke. The four word joke, mm-hmm. Venison's deer, isn't it?
I saw that one. I was going to put that up. I didn't actually put it up. So, Andrew, thanks so much for taking time out today to be on our podcast.
Thank you very much for having me, Dave. It's good to reconnect, to use an LA term.
Yeah. I'm hoping to do this a bit more. I kind of need to dip into my contacts to find out. I mean, I'm glad to have you on. You were one of the few technical or really technical comedians I found out there. You're as much interested in doing comedy as in how it works and how to kind of make it work better. You also helped to kind of try and get this podcast going on.
Which is handy. I'm obsessed with the inner workings of comedy. It's a disease.
It is, isn't it? And I always find, like, yeah, the cool thing about comics is that if you do it, you kind of, I think you have that inside you. Well, there's a few exceptions. People they're like savants. They just kind of, you ask them how they do it. I think I asked Luke Heggie one time. He was very good, but like, yeah, I just went up there and just said it. You know, he just kind of, he didn't really seem to introspect into the world as much as most people did or do.
Well, I mean, if you see him now, he's probably the best comedian in Australia right now. He's just a writing machine. Like, he's like Australia's Mark Twain, basically. Like, his writing is just impeccable. Every word,
mm-hmm.
Anyway, he's not doing one-liners. It's the wording is impeccable.
So what are you up to? I suppose you're in lockdown. I think everybody's gigs have been cancelled for the next 3 to 5 months. I think this will be the one of about 60,000 podcasts that have been released at the moment, with people being stuck at home. But what's on the horizon for you?
Oh, I just released my podcast, my own personal one. I do a history podcast, which is quite successful in Australia, called the Rugby League Digest.
Mm-hmm.
And I've just released my one called the Andrew Paskin Podcast. So that one's about comedy and crime. So,
and when did that come out? Is that up on the iTunes, all the socials?
That comes out every Friday. It's called the Andrew Paskin Podcast, which is the most narcissistic title possible.
Yeah, no, I went with the title. I like the radio shows where breakfast show with so-and-so, but when they get like the other host in, they still have to say it's with so-and-so. So you kind of, you get to have your name used even if you're not doing it. So that's why it's the gurus of comedy with Dave Keeshan going to get this up and running and then fob it off to some intern. But they still have to kind of vamp the name.
Well, maybe I'll take it off your hands.
Maybe. I think there was a few times when we both kind of did a bit of work on the Comedy on the Edge podcast, and we would kind of take it over from time to time. When
it's funny because I told you that the Audacity instructions that you wrote and screenshotted painstakingly about eight years ago, I still use them today.
Yeah, no, I've actually had to track them down. I kind of put them up somewhere. A lot of people have asked me, you know, how do you do a podcast? And it's like, okay, I think I have them around somewhere. So I'm publishing them on the website too, just to kind of get people up and running.
You'll be proud of me, David. I've gone from absolute novice to intermediate on Audacity.
Intermediate? I was like, you know, I want to be president. No, wait, junior vice president. Okay, so thanks very much, Andrew. We'll kind of hopefully talk to you again. That's been me, Dave Keeshan. This has been Gurus of Comedy. We should all be up on iTunes and Deezer and Spotify and anywhere else you find podcasts. So please check us out there. Leave some 5 stars and tell us what you think. And that's it. Goodbye.
Toodaloo.